Good evening and welcome to US President Churchy with me, Charlie Banks. Tonight, I'll be talking to students at the Slope Bar in Sussex University. But first, I have an exclusive interview with Clive Webb, who will be talking about the logistics of this campaign. Over to you, Clive.
When American citizens cast their votes on Tuesday, technically they aren't voting for any of the candidates. They're voting for a group of people called electors. These are state officials who will represent each one of the 50 states that make up the union. The Republicans and the Democrats hold a monopoly. So what the candidates need to do in the election is to win a majority of those electoral college votes. That's a total of 240. I think Americans are fed up with their own political system and the deadlock that has characterized it for a long period of time. What we're seeing in this election is people voting largely for what they consider to be the lesser of two evils.
We're in New York as the land of the free chooses its destiny.
I'm supporting Donald Trump because he's amazing and he's very funny and he's a legend. And then I like him very much.
All eyes in Florida at the moment. For both sides, there is still all to play.
A very good night tonight.
And who are you going to be supporting?
I'm supporting Hillary Clinton.
Why?
Hillary Clinton. Why? Because I'm scared of Donald Trump.
Who am I supporting? Yeah, I'm supporting Clinton.
Why?
I kind of think it's a bit of a no-brainer at this point. I think, honestly, there's no option to support anyone else.
So, you're having a good night tonight?
I'm having a great night, yeah. And I absolutely support Trump throughout this election. I think we'll see that Hillary will actually win, which is a little unfortunate.
Like much better night for Donald Trump and his campaign team.
What happens, folks, if Trump gets it?
I'm going to Mars.
I don't know.
War, lots of war, and America will collapse.
Nuclear winter.
Trump, Donald Trump.
The way Ohio goes has been the way the country has gone.
In the 1930s, we had a Holocaust where people were massacred and killed. And this is a situation which is parallel in so many ways. The rhetoric that Donald Trump is talking about in terms of Mexican people, in terms of people of different racial minorities, he's suggesting that literally we should kill them, we should exile them, we should mark them with some kind of mark. The fact that we've got to this point where somebody who's essentially a rape, accused of rape, and also has sexually assaulted women is actually running for president shows that the sickness in the American system.
So apparently we've gathered that you're guilty before you go to court.
I just want to go over to the Trump headquarters because Mr. Trump hasn't just won Ohio, he's won it big time.
We have to choose from two evils, and I think a corrupt politician becoming the most powerful person in the United States and the world, as a matter of fact, that is more atrocious than having somebody like a crass cook like Donald Trump becoming the most powerful person in the world. I think that's preferable.
This is a very unexpected turn. The night started out somber. It is anything but right now, George.
This means that Donald Trump will be the 45th president of the United States, winning the most unreal, surreal election we have ever seen. This candidacy starting on an escalator ride.
I think that, like many people, I'm taken aback by the result. The potential impact of Trump implementing all of the policies to which he's committed himself on the campaign trail will be profound. I think that Donald Trump's election may have serious adverse consequences for the special relationship between Britain and the United States. The protectionist policies of Donald Trump may make that a difficult process. There are checks and balances in the American system of governance that will make it difficult for Donald Trump to be able to deliver on all of his campaign commitments. And then there's the fact that in not delivering everything to which he has committed himself, he has in this campaign unleashed forces that may be beyond his control by pandering to the basest prejudices of the electorate. If he's not ultimately able to provide the solutions that people believe he can deliver, then it could cause all sorts of consequences.
Thank you, Clive. We would not have been able to get that insight without you. So it's the morning after the election, and I've been talking to people in Brighton about what they think.
I wasn't happy.
Why?
Because I wanted Hillary Clinton to win. You said some awful things to start with, but then again, I don't feel she's, I don't know, up to it.
I think the morning's about the same.
So there you have it. Trump has won over Clinton, one of the biggest upsets in US political history.
There's been a lot of speculation about what a Trump presidency would mean for LGBT people, and despite recently waving an upside-down rainbow flag at a rally, his track record isn't good. There's already been a Trump effect with an increase in hate crime and bullying following his lead in his speeches.
To see this guy, I don't know what I said,
His policies and proposals are openly anti-LGBT, and he's vehemently against marriage equality.
Gay marriage, what do you stand?
I'm against gay marriage. Mm-hmm. I am not in favor of gay marriage.
Are you saying that if you become president, you might try to appoint justices to overrule the decision on same-sex marriage?
I would strongly consider that, yes.
Donald Trump has endorsed various anti-LGBT laws, including North Carolina's notorious HB2, the anti-trans bill that removes LGBT...